it's just not going great right now, to be honest.
This is the look a Karen gives you right before she tells you she can't wear a mask because she has a breathing problem.
My doctor said I'm a TERF. I can't wear a mask. Ooh.
I've twisted myself. Okay. I gotta twist back the other way. There's only one way out of that.
Hi, and welcome to another episode of Murder's a Drag with me, Aura Van Dank. I'm your host. I studied a murder. I did a case. I did some research. It was sad, but fulfilling, because somebody needs to tell these stories. They're not being told often enough. This week, I got most of my information from the Dallas Advocate in a few articles by Trudy Ring, as well as CNN articles by Emanuela Grinberg. I got a lot of my information from the CNN articles and local NBC Dallas-Fort Worth channels, news stories, and videos. Last year in 2019, the mass murder of trans women, specifically black trans women, caught the attention of national media, became a news story, but nothing more than just a news story to people. Different outlets had started spewing different numbers and statistics about trans women being murdered, and those statistics alone are harmful because when trans people are murdered, they're not always reported on as the gender that they are. They'll be given their dead name and misgendered in the autopsy reports or the murder reports. So those numbers are already skewed, they're not correct, and they just sort of diminish and you're turning people into statistics. You need to say their names. The number of violent crimes against black trans women continued and continues to rise at an exponential rate. Black trans women are being murdered left and right. People are trying to get stuff done, but it seems as though every time we get started in the right direction, in one case somebody else is murdered, and the momentum has to be built once again for this next person who was murdered. All the while, the murders are not stopping, they're not slowing down, they're happening every day, and with more frequency rather than with less. These skewed numbers and misgendering and incorrect reporting is one of the most frustrating things about these mass murders that people aren't really understanding, because, you know, it's like the human path, I suppose, to just put statistics and numbers on things that are happening instead of, you know, giving it a little bit of humanity, a little bit of empathy, and actually working towards solving the cases rather than just listing names in some sort of repository. Malaysia Booker was born on January 14th, 1997 in Houston, Texas. She was born to her parents Stephanie Houston and Pierre Booker. Malaysia didn't see eye to eye with her mother very often. She was raised Christian, so her mother had a hard time accepting her identity. I don't want to say it's because she was a Christian, but that seemed to definitely have something to do with it. Her mother has even admitted to still struggling to accept her daughter for who she was. She grew up in the South Dallas area, which is pretty impoverished. There's lots of boarded up windows and it's kind of mal-maintained. She had a lot of love for the city and the community that she grew up in. She made a lot of friends and she had this really bright personality that stuck out from other people. Even before she began her transition, it was just very, very exuberant. Malaysia loved to constantly get glamorous and be the center of attention. She just couldn't get enough of feeling beautiful in her own skin, and she was very good at doing that. When Malaysia became a teenager, she would escape that community where she was so well known as this person she'd be living as for years who wasn't truly her, and she would go to the more glamorous area of Oaklawn in Dallas, where things were more gentrified and streets were rainbow clad and there was shops and new apartments everywhere, drag shows. She was exposed to queer culture for the first time and quickly made friends and found people who did love her for exactly who she was, with no concessions. Once she truly started to embrace herself for who she was, Malaysia became popular in the community, probably just because she was stunning and she wasn't very shy. People say that you dress for success, and Malaysia always dressed like she was a supermodel fresh off the runway or on her way to an interview with Vogue. And that's the impression that people got from her, and it really made her popular. She had this quick wit, and Malaysia also loved to do makeup. She was a makeup artist through and through, very creative with her makeup looks, and she made a lot of friends in the makeup community among the MUAs. It actually took me an embarrassingly long time to realize that MUA stood for makeup artist. I couldn't do the math. on that one. I wasn't putting the two together, the three together. See, I'm not. Malaysia loved to put a look together just to take pictures, get that look and get that perfect selfie, perfect Instagram post. And she often did so with her good friend who was also a makeup artist, Jessica Anderson. I gotta wig cap up this whole experience because it's really not, my hair is getting long. It's not working in my favor today. There we go. Egg. Malaysia was a person who was absolutely devoted to her passions and devoted to her friends and family. When Jessica's father passed away, Malaysia did not have a ride to the services, but still got dressed and ready and walked miles in the Texas heat just so she can sit next to her friend in her time of need. Malaysia was the friend who would drop everything and come to your side if you really needed her. Malaysia was also what I'll refer to as, I guess, a reluctant activist. That same friend, Jessica, kind of put it best in a quote. She said, she had a heart of gold. She didn't want to experience all of this tragic stuff, but she wanted everyone to see the injustice and pay attention. Malaysia was not in a great place because of the constant exposure to the news stories and the reality that trans women, black trans women just like her, were being murdered every day and not a whole lot was being done about it. The world was just kind of watching. But she still wanted people to know, and she didn't want people to turn the blind eye like they had been doing, and she wanted change, truly wanted change. She was tired of it. She didn't want to have to do the advocacy that she was doing, but she had to do it because she was living her life as a black trans woman, and that was making her a target. Simply by existing, she was a target. Malaysia was definitely a very receptive empath, if I've ever seen one. So she never really wanted to be this advocate, but she felt obligated to speak for her sisters who couldn't speak for themselves. This sense of obligation, I believe, came from the incident where she was the survivor of a very brutal hate crime in the parking lot of an apartment complex in South Dallas that went viral, and the video of the brutal beating went all around the internet and everybody saw it. She survived, however, and that kind of gave her this sense of obligation that she had to speak for those trans sisters who were murdered and didn't survive like she had in that instance. A lot of her friends think that this sense of obligation is what led Malaysia to run into so much tragedy and end up being taken the way that she was. Essentially, this advocacy that she was doing was putting a target on her that her friends were seeing, but Malaysia was fearless and she was willing to be a target to advocate. The viral incident that I'm referring to happened back in 2019 in April. Malaysia was at an apartment complex in Southeast Dallas when she accidentally backed into somebody's car in the parking lot. Before she had a chance to get out or look around or really do anything, she turned to her driver's side window where there was already a man there screaming irate and pointing a gun in her face. Malaysia did not know what was going on and immediately just started driving away when this car followed her out of the apartment complex, rammed so hard into this car to move it around in like a semicircle behind this sign to the apartment complex and then further ram into the back of the car to trap her in there. He claims that he stopped her so that she could pay for the damages, and it's clear to me that he did not care what the damages were when he decided that he was going to ram into this woman's car enough to trap her into the apartment complex so that they could brutally beat her in an act of disgusting mob violence. A crowd began to form when this irate man, Jagai Allison, he offered $200 to 29-year-old Edward Thomas if he would brutally attack and beat Malaysia. Thomas immediately slammed Malaysia to the ground, almost knocking her unconscious right then and there, and then started with a flurry of punches. Malaysia fought back with all that she had in her and tried her best to get away, but she was knocked unconscious by this mob of people kicking and stomping on her head, punching her in the face. She was completely unconscious, and she was dragged away by a group of women. She was very lucky to have survived that, a brutal attack, and those people are truly, truly disgusting for what they did. The justice for them will never be served. Realistically, they'll never find the people who were in that mob. They arrested one man, and I don't think that they'll ever arrest anybody else. It's been over a year. The entire incident was recorded and posted by one of the trash people who decided to take part in it, but was quickly reshared by activists and LGBT rights groups calling for action and arrests to be made in this brutal, brutal video. partly due to activism, but mostly due to society's insatiable lust to watch and experience violence. This video went viral, and there was an actual effort now to look for somebody who could have been in connection with this crime. When the police got involved, they found from the video, very hard work they did here, listening to this video, a man offered Edward $200 to beat Malaysia unconscious, and that's exactly what happened. And he would have continued beating her to death if these women hadn't physically had to drag her away from his fists. Edward was arrested, but nobody cheered yet, because just a few days later he bonded out of jail and walked free for a while. Shortly after that, he was found to be going to unapproved locations on his ankle monitor because, you know, he was out of jail on bond, so he still had to have the ankle monitor because he's a flight risk. And he was going to unapproved locations and ended up back in jail. So this trial begins, and a piece of shit rears its head from under a rock somewhere and begins to defend Edward Thomas for brutally attacking Malaysia Booker. For money, nonetheless. And as a good attorney does, this defender goes to Facebook and posts a transphobic tirade about how gender is determined by your genitalia, and just because you believe you're one thing doesn't make you another thing. You know, the whole transphobic rhetoric that people say that's really damaging and actually leads to more violence committed against transgender people. You know the one, right? He wanted to try to start portraying this idea that it was a fight between two men. So he officially, legally requested that the court deadname Malaysia throughout the proceedings as to not confuse anybody, because he wanted everybody to see Malaysia as a man. I mean, truly don't know how you went to law school and then come up with that defense. Mind you, this is last year. Andrew Wilkerson said, Malaysia Booker, he deadnames her, I will not do that, is legally male by gender. To name him Malaysia Booker could have the jury wrongfully conclude that dead name redacted is female. This is prejudicial against our client who is male. I don't have words for that. I think you guys are probably angry enough, just as angry as I was when I read that quote. And he never used the name Malaysia, by the way. He dead named her through that whole quote. I just can't even bring myself to do that for an example. Everyone was obviously disgusted and deeply offended by the remarks from this lawyer who were transphobic in a case that was a hate crime. The blood is boiling. The blood is boiling, I'll tell you what. Obviously, the judge denied this ridiculous request that can't be legal. This judge finds piece of shit Andrew M. Wilkerson, lawyer, in contempt of court for repetitive outbursts, and fines him with a nice old $500 charge, which I'm sure is nothing to him because he's a lawyer. He gets 14 days in jail, but he never even sees the inside of a cell because he bonded out before he even got the call, basically. And I guess he still gets to be a lawyer, which is fun. So look out for that piece of shit. When that info about his request at the trial, along with his Facebook posts, were released and found by the public, the iconic trans activist in Texas, Monica Roberts, aka Trans Riot or Trans G Riot, I'm not exactly sure how that's pronounced, took to her blog, Trans G Riot or Trans Riot, that she's been utilizing since 26 to expose injustices against transgender women and help to create a narrative and speak her feelings about the murders and prejudices and discrimination faced by Black transgender women, specifically in the Texas area. At one point in her post, she just starts tearing this man to shreds, which I loved, and I had to put this quote in there. She says, "When your client beat a trans woman unconscious on that day, April 12th, to the point that several cis women had to step in and physically remove her from your client's flying fists as he uttered homophobic slurs, yeah, Miss Attorney Thing, that's not a mere fight." Complete quote. I didn't make anything up that I just said. I love her with my whole heart. Monica Roberts, I hear you, I'm listening, and I love you. By October of 2019, Thomas and his attorney had changed their approach for whatever reason. It just wasn't working. They decided to go with a plea deal that would have Thomas plead guilty to a misdemeanor assault charge rather than the felony assault with the deadly weapon charge, the deadly weapon being his fists, because he clearly would have beat her to death had she not been pulled away from him. And they lessened the sentence in exchange that they took that plea deal. He was ultimately sentenced to 300 days in prison. That included time served. So the time that he spent in prison was not very much. I believe he would still be there right now. I'm not sure. I think that he may be out due to COVID, probably. Considering they put him in there on a misdemeanor charge rather than the felony charge that he deserved to be in there with, because he was willing to beat a woman to death for $200. Mind you, the $200 was robbed off of the unconscious Malaysia afterward. Between the time of that initial attack and the time of that sentencing in October of 2019, Malaysia had spoken at a rally organized by Abounding Prospect in regard to her recent attack, and she said, "This has been a rough week for myself, the transgender community, and the city of Dallas. Today, I can stand before you. Whereas in other scenarios, we are at a memorial. The time to seek justice is now." In the video of her speech, Malaysia is physically shaking, her voice is shaking, she's tearing up, she has to pause a few times through sobs. She's very clearly traumatized from almost being killed while a whole mob of people watched and recorded. And she had a few friends up there with her help her get through the speech, but it's really heart-wrenching to watch because you can truly see the trauma that she has just been through. She was just so scared of what's happening in the world, what had happened to her, and what could have happened to her. And that fear was obviously justified because not even a month later, Malaysia was murdered. She was found face down next to a golf course abandoned on the side of the road, dead from a gunshot wound. This case is hard to hear, it's hard to research, and it's hard to read about, but you can only imagine how much harder it is for the people who are close to Malaysia and the people living every day in crippling fear that it's going to be them next. This case puts into perspective just how scary it is because Malaysia's cries for help literally fell on deaf ears. People saw this woman be brutally attacked, and then she got on that microphone and she told people what was going to happen and what's happening every day, and that's exactly what happened. And here we are a year later, and it doesn't seem like anybody cares. Being that Texas hate crime laws do not cover crimes committed against those based on their gender identity, both instances, her murder and her previous attack, although they were hate crimes, were not considered hate crimes in Texas and had to be submitted to the FBI for federal review, which they were, and nothing ever came of it. That is probably why Mr. Thomas got away with almost beating a woman to death for $200, and why there's still been no suspects convicted of murdering Malaysia Booker. All of the attention turned to Thomas when the news broke that Malaysia was murdered, because he was the one who had just been on trial, or who had just been arrested, not on trial at this point, because he wasn't in jail at the time that Malaysia was murdered. He was in trouble for beating her, so why wouldn't he be the one that killed her? His defense staunchly said that there's no way that he could have been involved. And if it were any other defense attorney, I might believe that, but the fact that his defense already said the things that they said, I don't believe that he wasn't involved. As the investigation began, the detective started to look at other acts of violence against LGBT and trans women, as if there was some sort of serial killer on the loose doing this. Which really shows you just the either a denial or straight willfully ignoring the fact that this isn't a serial killer. This is the fact that the society hates black trans women and they keep getting beaten, targeted, and murdered. Police identified a 33-year-old Kendrell LeVar Lyles as a person of interest in a separate murder case where he had murdered two cisgendered people, Kenneth Kachaki and Letitia Grant. During the investigations into those murders, they identified Lyle's car as matching the car that Malaysia was allegedly seen getting into at this intersection in Southeast Dallas. They then allegedly traced his phone to that location multiple times. Like, I guess they found that it was a location that he frequented by tracking his GPS phone thing. And they also allegedly found phone records of correspondence between Lyles and Malaysia. None of that was ever released. So I don't know. It doesn't sound right to me. And just like me, many other people are skeptical that this is the right guy. And that's mostly because the police originally said that he was a suspect in another high-profile transgender murder of Chynelle Lindsay, who was also murdered in Dallas, Texas. She was murdered after Malaysia, and she was found floating in a lake in the same area, kind of under the same circumstances, so that was kind of leading them to believe that it was a serial killer, which is just when they started placing all the trans people who were murdered into this category, all killed by this person, and when it was released that he wasn't the murderer for all of those women, people really started to doubt that real work was done. The FBI never came in, and we know when the FBI doesn't come in, real work isn't done. Police were real excited to release that they had found this serial killer that they think was murdering all the trans people, and that transphobia does not in fact exist, and it is just one serial killer who is the only transphobe in the world and the only person hurting trans women. That was a lie, because Ruben Alvarado is arrested for the murder of Chynelle Lindsay, and one of the other trans people that the detectives claim may have been a victim of this Lyles person was murdered by their roommate for completely different circumstances. So they really were just trying to pin all of these open cold cases, not even cold cases. These cases were still hot, they just weren't looking at them. They wanted to pin them all on this one guy and have their work just cut out for them. They even said that their work was cut out for them this weekend in one of the news stories. And I was like, ah, tell us how you really feel. Unfortunately, as far as the legal proceedings go, that's kind of where it stops. There's been no progress. It's been over a year. No conviction, no sentencing. It's unsolved and nobody's talking about it. People have such short-term memory, or they really just don't care. Malaysia's funeral service was absolutely beautiful. It was done as respectfully as possible, considering that the family was involved. And it was held in the Cathedral of Hope in the very neighborhood that Malaysia explored when she became a teenager and started to feel all of that love from the community. That love was shown to her for one last final time when they packed that huge-ass church full of people from Malaysia. Malaysia was laid to rest in this beautifully done, gorgeous blue casket, which was one of her favorite colors, and she was in a blue and white dress full of rhinestone Swarovskis. She had a Swarovski-stoned crown, tiara thing, and this really extensive and beautiful nail art. And she was truly glamorous for her final goodbye. This specific situation, strangely enough, of Malaysia laying in her casket dressed as a woman is something her mother specifically told Malaysia would never happen. Malaysia's mother decided to share very intimate details about the relationship that she had with her daughter at the funeral and only really proved herself to be problematic and not the best mother. While she spoke at Malaysia's funeral, she transitioned back and forth between calling Malaysia a he or a she, using correct pronouns and using incorrect pronouns. She switched between dead naming Malaysia and using the name Malaysia. She was very clearly not accepting of who her daughter was, and even fought for the terms loving son and glamorous daughter, or something to that effect, be printed on the program for her funeral. Loving son to be printed, and she wanted the dead name to be in there, not on the cover at least, and she also wanted pictures of Malaysia before she transitioned. She called that a compromise between herself, the family, and Malaysia's friends, and her real family of people who actually accepted this person for who she was, with no stipulations like her biological mother did. It's sick to me. And then she claimed that it was because she was scared, because it was already so hard for her gay son to live as a gay black man, and now he wanted to be a gay man who wanted to live as a transgender, is what she said. Those were her words. It does not make sense. And she cannot use that excuse of being scared, because I'm so sure that you were scared. Every parent of an LGBT child is scared. But you need to realize that your child is even more so terrified, and they don't need you telling them that at home. They need your love, they need your support, and that's it. They don't want your opinion. They don't want you to tell them what they are and are not, because they know what they are and are not. We're humans. We have that capability from the moment we're born till the moment we die. Instead, she said she was willing to die behind it, referring to her identity, Malaysia's identity. That's why it's well with my soul. Only because your child is dead now is their identity well with your soul, because she was willing to die behind that. Bitch, get the f*** off that pulpit. Let her real family speak. If you can't tell, that pisses me off. If there's one time that you're gonna respect somebody throughout their life cycle, it should be at their death. I don't know why that's a problem. Especially for the biological mother of somebody. I'll never be able to wrap my head around that. She made all those comments in a room full of activists who were attending Malaysia's funeral because all of them saw themselves in Malaysia. Just like Malaysia saw herself in the people murdered before her, all of her trans siblings saw themselves in Malaysia after she was murdered and had to sit there and listen to what I am sure they have heard before from their mother or father or their family, while Malaysia's mother sat up there and said, I had a son, and my son is supposed to act a certain way, and my daughter's another way, so you can see why this was hard for me. Honestly, no, I can't. I'm sorry, I can't relate, because I'm a decent human being. Anyway, Malaysia's father seemed significantly less problematic, like maybe he actually cared about his daughter, and not about the attention that he was now getting because his daughter's dead. He was quoted saying, it's sad that Malaysia had to become famous after her death, because she always wanted to be famous while she was growing up. He said that that was something, if he remembered anything about her childhood, it was that Malaysia wanted to be famous. That was her goal. She wanted to be a star. Just famous because she was Malaysia. She was unique. She was talented. She was gorgeous. She was outgoing. She should be famous. A personality. Why not? And her auntie, Jasmine Banz, kind of echoed that sentiment. She said, she wanted to be famous for what she was already doing. She didn't want to be their poster child. She wanted to be famous for her Facebook segments that she would do called Storytime, where she would just kind of talk about what she was going through on Facebook Live, what her day was like, anything that had happened to her that day, any kind of stories that she had from the week about being trans or about feeling good about herself, about kicking dysphoria's ass or about falling under dysphoria's spell. You know, she aired it all out. It was like her personal diary. And she got popular for that. And that's what she wanted to be famous for. She didn't want to be the poster child for violence against trans women or murdered trans women. Miss Monica Roberts was at the funeral for Malaysia, and she was quoted saying before the service began, we want the same thing as everybody else. We want to be left alone so we can thrive and contribute our talents to the rest of our community. But we can't do that if we have to look over our shoulders and worry about getting killed at any given moment. That's just the terrifying truth and reality that people live every day. There's not more that I can add to that quote, and there's nothing that I can say. It's very on the nose and straightforward. It's lipstick, lashes, costume, wig, you know, the whole 9 yards, or 3 yards, 4. Transformation time. That's what it is. And that's the look for this week. Big ol' hair by Ariel Versace. Good old gown. Little gown number. Want me to stand up and model it for you? Oh my god, you won't be able to see the rest of my body, but I'll do it anyway. Okay. I'm gluing my wigs down, even though I take them off approximately 5 minutes after recording these videos. Let's get a look at her. Ooh. That was this week's story. I hope you learned something about the life of Malaysia Booker. Now I've made you aware that this murder still has not been solved. The attention that this case garnered has all but fizzled out, and Malaysia needs us to say her name, to keep her case relevant, and to get the people who killed her brought to justice. I'll see you next week. Mm-hmm.